I would like to call a regular meeting of the Board of Trustees, January 9, 2018, to order. Would you kindly join the board and myself in the Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America?
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Clerk Bruce, would you kindly call a roll?
Trustee Barr?
Present.
Trustee Cuevas?
Here.
Trustee Manzo?
Present.
Trustee Syed? Trustee Tiesinger?
Present.
Trustee Youssef?
Here.
And President Lamalani?
Here. Thank you. Opening comments first. I'd like to start off with a moment of silence. I was saddened to learn of the recent passing away of Mrs. Amparo Cuevas, aged 94. She was in good health, as I understand. She's a grandmother of our trustee, Phil Cuevas. I would like to take a moment of silence in honor of Mrs. Cuevas and her family. Thank you. Trustee Cuevas, kindly note, and you were aware that we are so sorry to hear of the recent loss during the holidays. If you would like to say a few words at this point, this would be a good time to say. I know she was in very good health. One of her gifts to Oakbrook was Phil.
Yeah, it was. She had a full life. She was a good woman. She was a grandmother of 14, great-grandmother of 13, so.
Oh, my goodness.
And it was a New Year's Eve surprise, so.
Very sorry to see the loss. Next, could we have a resolution of appreciation? The Village Board and I would like to recognize a few people for the service to the Village of Oakbrook in the Sports Corps Long Range Planning Committee. We have a resolution of appreciation to approve. And I request kindly Clerk Bruce to kindly read the resolution.
Resolution of appreciation. Whereas in 2013, the Sports Corps Long Range Planning Committee was formed and comprised of pertinent village staff and informed residents. And whereas the purpose of this committee was to make recommendations to the Village Board for the betterment of the Sports Corps, to bring the Bath and Tennis Club back into being a revenue generator and to access the long-term needs of the Sports Corps. And whereas between 2013 and 2017, the members of the committee participated in many discussions regarding Sports Corps memberships, facility management slash operations of the Bath and Tennis Club, capital improvements to the Sports Corps, marketing the amenities, and developing a master plan going forward. And whereas the committee members were instrumental in exploring strategies for improvements to both the golf club and the Bath and Tennis Club, as well as potential partnership opportunities with the Oakbrook Park District. And whereas the president and board of trustees of the Village of Oakbrook desire to recognize the following residents for their participation on this important committee: Don Adler, John Barr, Robert Barber, Jim Carson, Phil Cuevas, Sharon Knitter, Angie Lopez, Kathy Minoski, Kathy Merrick, Fred Trabetta, Deepak Upa. Now, therefore, be it resolved by the President and Board of Trustees of the Village of Oakbrook that the above-mentioned individuals be and are hereby commended for their loyal service to the Village of Oakbrook and the citizens thereof. Be it further resolved that the President and Board of Trustees of the Village of Oakbrook for and on behalf of said village and its citizens do hereby extend their appreciation and gratitude to these individuals for their civic service. Be it further resolved that a duly certified copy of this resolution be delivered to these individuals and that this resolution be spread upon the official permanent records of said village, adopted and approved by the President and Board of Trustees of the Village of Oakbrook, DuPage and Cook Counties, Illinois, this 9th day of January, 2018.
Thank you. At this point, I'll simply call for a voice vote. May I have a motion for approval of the resolution of appreciation as just read by Charlotte Pross, R1696?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Any objections? Motion carries. And if there are any members, recipients of this resolution and appreciation in attendance, kindly come forward and be recognized for your service. I know there are a couple of trustees who served on this committee, and we thank you and recognize you, and your certificates are right here. Thank you. On your way out, pick it up. Yeah. There. Before we go on to visitor comments, one quick comment, just to wish each one of you a happy New Year. I am sure you had a nice Christmas and New Year holiday with your family, friends, and your loved ones. And I'd like to take a moment to wish you a happy, hearty, hopeful, healthy, and harmonious 2018. Are there any visitor comments, Charlotte?
The ones that signed up are for the Clearwater Senior Center. None right now, please.
Okay. Approval of the minutes. Could I have a motion to approve the minutes from the executive meeting of November 28, 2017?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Seeing no objections, motion carried. Next, may I have a motion for approval of the minutes from the meeting of December 12, 2017?
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say yes.
Yes.
Motion carried. I'll now kindly request that you direct your attention to the screen where the consent agenda is available for viewing. Before we go on with the consent agenda, I would like to extract item 6A1 pertaining to CDS Office Technologies to be discussed at a future meeting in February. Are there any other extractions? Yes, Trustee Manzo?
6A6 and 6E8.
6A6 and?
And 6E8.
Okay. All right, any other extractions? Yeah.
Yes, 6F.
Four score long, okay. Any others? None. May I have a motion to approve the consent agenda with the exception of the extractions and authorize the expenditures as presented?
So moved.
Second.
Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Okay, motion carries. Trustee Manzo, your extraction?
I'll move 6A6, Williams Architect.
Second.
I'll call for the question. I've already made my opinion known at previous board meetings regarding this matter.
Any further discussion? Seeing none, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
No.
Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
And Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Motion carries. Next, I believe, Trustee Manzo, you're still in order.
6E8, Resolution 218BDCLRECDR 1697, Resolution authorizing the destruction of verbatim recordings of certain closed meetings of the Village Board of Trustees. I'll move.
Second.
Call for the question.
Did you want to make a point?
No. Okay. I'll make a comment on this.
Go ahead.
As chairman of the Fire Commission, Police Commission for many years, you have the verbatim, and then those get written up and get approved, and the state allows for the destruction of the verbatim tapes, which are all digital now, after a certain length of time. And this is just a standard procedure of all governments according to the Open Meetings Act.
Yeah, it's a standard procedure, and there's been times where we've been told to hold those minutes because there was the Attorney General looking into certain meetings. Just making my point that, and I know we're limited on what we can discuss, but this is a practice that's done many times without even knowledge of the board. It is a common practice. Trustee Barr is correct. We are allowed to do it. That's absolutely true. But we've had controversy here at the Village of Oak Brook regarding this practice.
Any further comments? Yes. Trustee Youssef?
Yeah, Trustee Manzo, are there items in these recordings that you feel need to be preserved specifically at this time?
As I stated years ago when it first came up and the Attorney General told us we couldn't destroy the minutes we were trying to destroy, there has to be something in place. There has to be a process in place, and I don't think there is. It gets placed on the consent agenda, not even a regular agenda item. And I know this is standard practice. I know it's not improper. I know it's not illegal. I know it's done all the time, but I think there's a better way that it can be done.
Please propose it, and I'm sure the rest of us would be willing to.
I'll propose it again.
Hear it out.
Any further comments? Did you have a comment, Mr. Jones?
No.
Roll call vote, please.
Trustee Manzo?
No.
Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Motion carries. And one more agenda. Sports call loan, Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes, I'd like to move to discuss item 6F.
Second.
This is the sports core loan. Every year we have a loan from the general fund into the sports core, it seems, and this year is no exception. But this year we did have something else new, and in my packet, the PDF page was page 121, which was Jason's one-page memo urging us to approve the $250,000 sports core loan. But then on page 137 of the packet, we have a spreadsheet. And this spreadsheet says the monthly operating statement of the Sports Core Fund consolidated presentation for the period ending November 30, 2017. And along the bottom here, we have something called Transfer to Golf Surcharge Fund. And so this is sort of the aftermath of our golf surcharge fund discussion. As I understand it, what we did was we put about $130,000 of the new money for 2017 into a separate sports core surcharge fund. And the question was, what do we do with the legacy balance, which had a title on it called surcharge fund of roughly $500,000, but which was in fact commingled with the general sports core fund. It wasn't really a separate sub fund. So since it wasn't really a separate sub fund, and since it didn't go into the actual new golf surcharge fund, if it was all really true, everything that we heard at the prior meetings, it seems like we already have about $500,000 of commingled money in the Sports Core General Fund, which used to carry the fictional appellation of the Golf Surcharge Fund. So if we actually have money in the fund that's no longer encumbered by being called something that it never was, my question is, why do we need $250,000 of a loan from the general fund of the village into the Sports Core Fund if there's already $500,000 perched in there that was collected from the golf surcharge revenue?
Yes. For fund alone in operating cash has nearly $500,000 there. This is a just in case they need it. I mean, if they don't need it, not a penny of this will ever get used. This is just a, rather than if, you know, there's capital, if there's, you know, the park district, you know, there was the proposal to take money from them. You know, who know? I don't know what the payment schedule is at. If they want the money up front, if they want, it's just kind of a just in case. There's a need for cash. We have this there. But like I said, if it's not needed, it won't be used.
But wasn't the just in case motivated in part by the fiction of supporting the golf surcharge fund that wasn't really a fund? You always wanted to kind of buffer that from actually being spent in prior years?
That was always the intention, I believe.
So if we've now disregarded the false characterization of a separate fund, and if it's commingled in there with the revenues that are there, do we still need $250,000 on top of that?
But those monies are now separated.
How much did we separate? Because that gets to my question about 137. I saw
$550,000.
Did we take $550,000 and put it into the golf surcharge fund?
Yes.
So we did not take only the new money from 2017. We took all the money?
We took the new money and then the money previous to. That was part of the budget amendment that we passed, I believe, in September. That said that we were going to take all that money. I believe at the last meeting, I was asked to reach out to the finance liaisons. I talked to both. I think both agreed that that money should be in one place. So that's where we put it, in one place.
Okay, so the golf surcharge fund that was commingled got uncommingled and turned into a real fund?
Yes.
To the extent of 500 and some thousand dollars?
To the extent that we had money set aside that we were tracking, yes.
Okay, and so then the implication of that is, now that it's not commingled with the general fund, now in fact we're out of money, and now we need $250,000.
No, like I said, there's 550,000 of operating cash in the sports core. If they don't need any money to borrow money to pay bills, to pay the park district, to pay staff, then it's not going to be used. It's, like I said, it's just a just in case if they need it. Obviously, if it's not used, that'd be great. If a small amount of it is used, it's going to get paid back.
Okay, well, I'll admit that I don't fully understand why we're doing what we're doing, but thank you for offering your clarifying comments.
Any other comments? Seeing none, roll call vote, please.
Okay. Trustee Tiesinger?
No.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Mansell?
Yes.
Okay, motion carries. Moving down to agenda number 8, Clearwater Development. Trustee Barr, would you present ordinance 1183 and make the appropriate motion?
I move to concur with the recommendations from the Plan Commission and Zoning Board of Appeals and approve the amendment to the special use for the Sheraton at Oak Brook, a luxury senior housing development consisting of 200 apartments, subject to the following conditions. One, that all previously approved special uses and variations granted to this property not in conflict with this request will remain in full force and effect. Two, obtain final approval of the proposed variations required to construct the 200-unit senior housing development. Three, notwithstanding the attached exhibits, the applicant shall meet all village ordinance requirements at the time of building permit application, except as specifically varied or waived. And four, authorize the village attorney to prepare the necessary ordinance for final consideration at the January 23rd, 2018 Board of Trustees meeting.
Is there a second for discussion?
Second.
Trustee Barr, any comments?
Yeah, I am in favor of this development, and I'd like to go down a number of reasons why I am in favor of this. I did go up to the Sheraton of Northbrook and spent 2.5 hours up there touring the facility. I found it to be a outstanding facility, and in my opinion, it would be a great asset to Oak Brook, and one that has very little competition in the area, and therefore, I believe that there is a need. When my mother, in her last 7 years of life, was in a very nice outfit near here, but it would have been nice for her to be in Oak Brook. I believe that there are a lot of people in Oak Brook that feel the same way about their parents, or people in Oak Brook who are older, moving from the house, they would like a housing option like this. We took my mother out to lunch, to dinner, often, took her to church, brought her over to the shopping center. So the seniors who are going to be there are going to be using our village retail. They're not just going to be housed in this and not being getting out. These are going to be active seniors, many of them. So I just think that there's a great need for this in this town. I've had neighbors who have put parents in nearby facilities not as nice, who wished to have their parents closer to them and in town. So that's the first reason. Second reason, the $79 million facility is going to generate $1+ million in building fees to Oak Brook. Last year, we had the whole year, we had $2.3 million. The year before, $1.8 million. The year before that, in 2015, $1.5 million. So with this one development, we're going to get $1+ million of fees to Oak Brook. I had a long discussion also with the York Township assessor who deals with senior lifestyle homes like this. And after much calculation and discussion, he came up with an appraisal for this as close to $40 million, which applying the tax rate that is in that district, same as with Hub, and I pulled up Hub's tax bill to make sure that this was verified, that would generate $760,000 in annual tax dividends to the area of facilities. And more importantly, because School District 205, which is the York School District, Forest Glen and Woodside Estates, those students go there, they would get $631,000, ballpark figure. That equates in 10 years to $6.3 million for the schools. So when you're looking at school district, not just Oak Brook, but looking globally at what this development will do, $630,000 to schools every single year in new money. And school districts, when they do their levies, they capture new construction. It's very different than capturing the old construction that's under the tax cap. If you doubt this, you can look at Oak Brook. I looked at their, under a GIS system, I looked up Northbrook with 156 units. Oak Brook has 200. And I believe what the assessor told me was pretty close to being on what's going to be reality. Four, I think the height of this building is really nice. It's going to be about six stories, which balances all the buildings in that area. Balances the Drake Tower, which is kind of kitty corner, balances the Hub, it balances the new orthopedics building. If you remember the John Buck in Clearwater in this plan unit development had an okay for hotel, condo, retail that was 17 stories. This would stick up like a sore thumb. Having senior lifestyle here would put a quality building in this place, a solid masonry building that would be in keeping with the character of this whole area in Oak Brook. And it would maintain this kind of gateway into Oak Brook. So, and then five, this property was shopped, extensively shopped. Even Jupiter, who wants to put a 27-story condo building on 1900 Spring on a very small little postage stamp piece of property, wasn't interested in putting their really nice building here, where they would have much more land, a view of the creek, and just being able to do so much more than they're doing, perhaps, over where they want to put the building. So I think that these the people who are behind this development have done their homework, they've done their due diligence, and they're offering Oak Brook a chance to diversify needed housing choices for our seniors, and at the same time to bring much needed revenue into this town. So for those reasons, I am definitely for this.
Thank you. Unless there are any trustee comments, is there anybody who wants to make comments? Why don't we start with the residents first?
Okay, I have John Grissom.
Oh.
My name is Bridget O'Keefe. I'm the attorney for Senior Lifestyle. And when we spoke with staff, they said that we could make a short presentation to provide more overview. Would this be an appropriate time?
This would be a good time.
Do you want to make the comments first, Gopal?
Did you want to make a comment?
No. Go ahead. Make the presentation.
No, go ahead.
I can make it afterwards.
Yeah. We could hear the presentation. Are there any residents at all, or are they all from the...
I have Emil Haddon, and he lives in Elmhurst. Is that for the Clearwater? Did you want to speak? Okay.
I would like to get the resident comments done, first? And then that way you could respond to any questions that they bring up.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. Yeah, please.
I think the only other one is...
Thank you. My name is Emo Haddad. I live in Elmhurst. I'm actually here on behalf of my wife, who's out of town and unable to be here tonight. My wife, Jackie, serves on the Senior Commission for the City of Elmhurst and the Senior Commission for York Township. And she was going to come and speak, so on her behalf. It's interesting that you mentioned about the increased participation in shopping and restaurants. But there's something else I'm going to ask you to consider, and that is that just like any business, there's a high time and a downtime. For example, if you're going to go out with your family for dinner and you're going to go in the evening on a Friday night, you're better off ordering a pizza and staying home. But with this facility, your seniors are available during the daytime when maybe the restaurants are not filled or the shopping center isn't that busy. And there's going to be transportation to take them to these to Oak Brook. They're going to have transportation to take them where they want to go. So your sales tax is going to have a positive effect on this. So I ask that you consider that. And of course, the fact that you have senior housing all over the state of Illinois. Some are Cadillacs, some are Chevrolets. I've examined this because I hope in the future to come in myself. And there's no doubt in my mind, if you bring this in here, you're going to have the Cadillac. Thank you.
Any other residents?
I think Chuck and Jory Thompson. I think everybody else is.
Sheridan, yeah.
Good evening, everyone. Good to see everyone again. I'm Chuck Thompson, speaking for Joy, who's 100% owner of Steam Coffee Company that was opened this September. She has a heart of service. Notwithstanding the fact that there's a self-interest to grow her business right in the Clearwater development and having a wonderful, inviting place for seniors to come and have coffee and meet up with one another, she does have a heart of service and thinks that this would be a great addition to that area that's a little bit more corporate area or transient with the LA Fitness folks. And this gives a little bit more, to Trustee Barr's comments, a little bit more of a downtown residential feel where seniors can come and meet with friends, out-of-town friends, and our main concern was the parking, but I have to give credit to Lincoln. They have assuaged our concerns about that, as well as the Senior Lifestyle Center. So as residents and business owners, Chuck and Joy Thompson want to just say we hope you consider those things, that it'd be a great place to have our families and our friends and our seniors cared for in the development. So thank you very much.
The other thing I wanted to say, I think everybody else is from Clearwater. Did I miss a resident? Because I don't want to do that. Those are the only two
let's
residents.
Go ahead and,
Okay, good evening. Again, my name is Bridget O'Keefe. I'm here on behalf of Senior Lifestyle. We'd like to start out by, first of all, thanking the Village of Oak Brook for the considerable time that's been spent studying this proposal over the past few months. The staff and everyone we've had the opportunity to meet with and who've taken the time to come and see us and talk with us has been so helpful in helping us think through the development and make sure that we can try to address any concerns that you all have. We've been very encouraged by the strong support that we've received to date for the project. After several hours of hearings before the Plan Commission, we received a 5-1 vote. We then went on to the Zoning Board of Appeals for several more hours of hearings, and we received a unanimous vote, 7-0. We believe that this support, which we've also have a positive staff recommendation, we have support of all of our neighbors. We believe that all of this flows from the kind of benefits that this is going to provide, which which has been so ably referred to by Trustee Barr, and we appreciate his words and support. We have made an extensive record showing the project's compliance with the special use and variation standards that are outlined in the code. It is probably that thick and consists of a transcript of many, many hours of hearings. We were going to have this matter considered in November, but we decided to defer it to allow more time for discussion and debate because we want to make sure that we address any questions you all have had, and we hope that we will do so this evening. In the interest of time, we're going to rely a lot on the record that's already been made to meet the legal standards. We are only going to have two formal witnesses. One is Bob Goronsky from Senior Lifestyle, who provide an overview of the development, and then John Grissom from Lincoln Properties, which is a landowner, who can give you a little bit of feedback about the due diligence that they've done over the past 2.5 years to find the right user. Because what they heard you say in 2015 when they purchased the property was that it was really important to complete Clearwater. Lot 6 has been vacant for 10 years, and they were told by the village that this is an important gateway, and they want to make sure that the development is complete and it has the right user. And Lincoln Properties comes before you tonight to describe why they think this is the right use. We also have a development team here who will not provide formal testimony, but are available if you all have any questions. We have Joe Patrick from Senior Lifestyle and George Halleck, who the project architects. They can address questions on landscaping design or parking or landscaping design or engineering. We have Tim Doran from Sam Schwartz, parking and traffic expert, and we have Brendan Reedy with Cushman Wakefield, who's a retail broker who has been involved with the site for many years. They will be available if there's any questions that John or Bob cannot answer. So we'll try to be efficient and respectful of your time. So I'm going to turn it over to Bob.
All right. Thank you. For the record, my name is Bob Goronsky. I'm Vice President of Development for Senior Lifestyle, based here in Chicago at 303 East Wacker. First of all, I'd like to echo the thanks and appreciation for all the hard work the staff has done and the trustees, and especially Trustee Barr, who I think went above and beyond to vet this proposal over the past several months. So I think the more information we can share with one another, the better, the end, result will be for everybody. And not knowing all the, concerns that might be out there, because we still have not had a chance to talk directly with some of the trustees, hopefully you'll share your questions openly in this setting and we can answer them for you. Just a quick reminder, it's, we first came here in July to present to you guys before going to the Plan Commission and then the Zoning Board of Appeals. And as Bridget said, at both of those boards, we received very strong support for what we're proposing to do, which is intended to be a signature community for senior lifestyle, comparable in quality to stuff we operate in places like Jupiter, Florida, and the North Shore of Chicago, in particular North Shore Place in Northbrook, which Trustee Barr had mentioned, is one that we think is on a par with this. The thing that's better about your development is we have an even more diverse product line. North Shore Place is 156 units of assisted living and memory care. This community, because of its location and the market and the desire to help enhance the community and have our seniors be, stay active in the community, we have 119 independent living apartments in addition to 66 assisted living and 15 memory care apartments. The assisted living and memory care, as we have said in past hearings, will be licensed by the Illinois Department of Public Health and will, in addition to all the hospitality services that are independent living residents receive, they'll also get assistance with activities of daily living from caregivers and licensed nurses. The building itself is proposed to be 6 stories, which we think is much better in the context than what had previously been approved in 2007. The important thing when this opportunity was brought to us by some of the condo developers that Lincoln Property was soliciting, the first thing that Lincoln Properties told us was that you know, as owner of all the other properties in Clearwater, and hearing what their tenants have expressed as concern and what they've seen firsthand over the years since they bought the place, is that parking and traffic is a real concern. And so one of the things they made clear to us that the retailers and office users have echoed is the importance of saving the existing surface lot parking that's there. Currently, there's 179 surface lot parking spaces on lot six that we intend to reconfigure but preserve for the ongoing use of all the existing all the other uses on the campus. To accommodate that and to address the parking needs of our own residents, staff, and visitors, we've had to design a building that has very expensive underground and in-building parking. So we will have a total of 185 parking spaces for our use, our exclusive use, all within the footprint of our building, either below grade or at grade, and I'll show you that plan in a second, while also preserving the 179 existing parking spaces for everyone in Clearwater to use. The landscape plan, one of the variances we had requested to enhance the selfishly the value of our property, but also anybody driving through the community, was to consolidate the landscaping at the entrance of the building instead of having little islands within the existing parking lot. One of the variances was to bring the landscaping to our main entry point, in this area here. The beauty of this site is it's not only connected to all the energy and vibrancy of the Clearwater Shopping Center and in close proximity, to the mall and to medical services, is we've oriented the building so that a lot of our outdoor space and common spaces will look to the serene setting to the west, where we've got the retention ponds and pathways for people to enjoy. The other thing that we took care to do so that we would fit nicely into the context of the setting is the vast majority of our common areas and community uses will be on the ground floor. So we'll have multiple dining options on the ground floor for our residents, our fitness center, our occupational therapy and PT therapy space, our salon, all of the key stuff that fits really well with the commercial uses in the area will present on that ground floor. The only residential, and really out of necessity for a quality program, are the 15 memory care apartments on the ground floor that, for security reasons, we've requested the variance of the 8-foot high fence so they can have some wonderful outdoor space to utilize while still being safe in their setting. The parking, as we had mentioned before, our residents and staff will actually enter the below-grade parking off of Clearwater Drive to the north and never really burden the traffic and parking in the center of the Clearwater development. Our visitors will come in and have some visitor spaces and a portico share, and then if they're staying for a while, they can enter at grade the enclosed parking for our visitors. And that will allow this area here to continue to serve the retail needs and the office needs and the other restaurants down here as it currently is. And there's just a picture of the garage entering off of Clearwater. So our residents, the seniors that have reached out to us for early information on what we're proposing to do, have all been thrilled that there's a secured enclosed garage space, especially when we were talking to them last week when it was -4 outside. The idea of an enclosed garage for all of our residents and their and the staff was really well received. Just to remind everybody, those who didn't have the time to go tour any of our higher end Chicago area properties, here are some pictures of North Shore Place. Obviously, the design is a little bit different. We were very responsive back in 2011, 2012, when we were going through the zoning process with the folks in Northbrook to design a building that met what they believed was appropriate for the setting. So the mansard roofs were actually a direct request. But you can get a sense of the quality of the interiors as well. This is a very high-end luxury alternative to, you know, currently what's available in the western suburbs that comes anywhere close to what we'll be offering is really only available in an endowment fee structure that's attractive to many, but it's also, you know, not the right option for a lot of other seniors looking for the quality and the amenities, but not wanting to plunk down 600 or 800,000 of their assets, you know, to have somebody else hold while they live in the community. As Trustee Barr noted, it's at least a $79 million investment in your community. You know, we're trying to create a luxury housing option that is available for your current seniors, for seniors who want to live in this community to be closer to their families, to be closer to the folks who work in this area. And quite honestly, you know, the Oak Brook address is a desirable address for all the obvious reasons. This is an incredible community. You only have about 7,000 or 8,000 lucky residents right now. And we think that by giving a lot of the seniors in the area something that's appropriate for their needs as they age and want to stay in the community, you'll also have the added benefit of freeing up some of the single family homes and existing condos in the marketplace to younger households, while not losing those key leaders in your community. You know, this is the last piece of the puzzle for Clearwater. John Grissom from Lincoln Properties will go through chapter and verse to remind you why, you know, notwithstanding the recession that happened in 2006 through 2008, why none of the original components of the John Buck plan make any sense. A lot of it has to do with the parking issues that currently exist there and the traffic issues, and a lot of it is simply, you know, the finances for those uses just don't make sense when it comes to addressing all the practical issues that Lincoln Properties and their users, you know, have to deal with moving forward. Unlike a lot of the proposed developments that, you know, may have been, you know, thought about for this site, we're actually going to employ a significant number of people on a permanent basis. We figure we're going to have 96 full-time equivalent employees, so more than 100 jobs will be brought after this building is built on a permanent, you know, basis. And those, you know, those employees, along with our residents and our residents' visitors and, you know, family members, will certainly be, you know, shopping and dining in Oak Brook and indirectly contributing to the, you know, the retail base that, you know, continues, you know, in your own words, in your 2018 budget, you know, that is continuing to see challenges. So, you know, that's why you've got letters on file now from Egg Harbor, from, you know, Joy and her husband at Steam Coffee, and the folks at Jason's Deli also see us as not only a solution long term to the parking needs, but understandably as a, you know, boon to their businesses, where our independent living seniors, unlike the assisted living and memory care where we're required by, you know, the state license to provide three meals a day, our independent living residents will have a flexible meal program that would, you know, encourage them to go dine out as frequently as they want. You know, Mr. Haddad and some of his friends met with me last week to find out more about our dining program and our, you know, hospitality services for the independent living, and they love the idea of having flexibility. Basically, our IL residents will have a dining allowance every month that they can use at any of the three meals for cocktails, for happy hour, for, you know, parties to treat, you know, their friend to lunch, but it's available all month long to spend down, so that if somebody wants to go meet their, you know, grandkids for breakfast at Egg Harbor, they don't feel like they're paying for breakfast twice, because that just frees up money for them to, you know, order a higher, you know, priced entree later in the month, or is, I think Mr. Haddad or maybe you know, it was one of his friends said, you know, invite friends over for cocktails in our bar in our building. But we want our residents out and engaged in the community at large, and our neighboring retailers see that and are excited about the prospect of the ongoing patrons that we're going to bring to them. You know, I had been lowballing the real estate taxes at about $540,000 a month, but I commend, you know, Trustee Barr on his research, and I will tell you that your, you know, research is comparable to the high end of what Jones Lang LaSalle said we could expect. I never want to overpromise, you know, the financial benefits of what we're doing, because I think even, you know, in a best case scenario from my position, even if we're paying $540,000 instead of over $700,000 a year in real estate taxes, that is real value to your community. Even though you as a village don't directly, you know, collect a millage from your real estate, you know, as it was pointed out, the school districts, you know, benefit. In this case, School District 205 benefits directly, and you know, one of the, you know, visions and mission statements that your community has is, you know, they both specifically focus on creating the best educational opportunities for its residents and award-winning schools. That's in your own, you know, published mission statement and vision for this community. And what better way, you know, to help, you know, ensure that than to have this windfall for School District 205. I think the only negative comment we heard in one of the earlier public hearings was, well, it's only for, you know, that side of town, you know, those three, you know, residential subdivisions, because, you know, the folks south in town go to a different school district. But, you know, it still doesn't take away from the fact that you have several hundred, you know, households that will benefit immensely from this windfall that District 205 will get.
Could we have the presentations a little condensed?
Oh, sure.
We just can't go on.
Yeah, and I apologize. We don't know all the questions. I'm trying to address the ones that were raised in, you know, in private discussions with staff.
Could you make it more concise?
Sure. Yeah, all right. So I'll condense it, because I think, you know, the early on in July and at some of the other public hearings we had, the question of what would our impact be on the emergency services, I think we've thoroughly vetted that with staff. Your own fire chief has, you know, called his connections in Northbrook. Trustee Barr has even read our policies and procedures, and, you know, and it's clear that, you know, I think everybody who's looked at the information we've presented kind of agrees that, you know, there really won't be that dramatic an increase on the emergency services, and I can address specifically why, you know, if though for those of you who might still have open questions about it, but in the interest of time, I'll pass over that. Then, you know, the only other thing I would say before handing it off to John is that, you know, some early in the process had expressed concern about what's the opportunity cost. It seems like everybody loves what we're proposing, but there may be some hesitation because, you know, maybe if we wait another 10 years or we wait another year or we wait another two, maybe the John Buck 2006 or even or 2007 or 2008 plan could come to reality. And I think the reality that's facing everybody right now is the opportunity that could be lost here is for this seniors housing development. There is a lot of competition in the area already. There's still a demand for this product, and it'll be wildly successful in that location in your community. But if we wait another year or two, somebody inevitably is going to build a comparable project in Elmhurst or in Hinsdale or in, you know, Westchester or Lombard, you know, probably less desirable for most of the seniors around here to live in those other communities, but it would eat up whatever statistical demand might be left. Right now is a great opportunity to do something that will be great for the community, great for retail business, great for your seniors, and actually addresses the very first two steps in your own strategic plan, which are, you know, to, you know, let's see here. I'll actually read them directly, because when you look at this, it's just, I think we check a lot of the important boxes. So the first two steps in your strategic plan for fiscal year 2018 is plans and codes that encourage new development. Here's a site that's sat underdeveloped for over a decade, and we can check that box. This is, you know, a great opportunity for new development. And more importantly, diversify housing options is your second step in your own stated goals and objectives. And this, as I think you know, your planning director had said, and forgive me for paraphrasing, if you were to master plan a community today, the one glaring omission from a housing perspective is purpose-built housing for seniors in this community. So if you were to start from scratch and say, what are we missing in Oak Brook? Your own planning director made, you know, that observation in one of the staff meetings that I was in. And again, forgive me if I paraphrased it a little liberally, but I think, you know, I think we're a great thing for your community. I hope you agree, and I hope you won't be shy in asking questions tonight if you do have concerns, because the best way to address them is to have open dialogue. So with that, I'll pass the microphone to John Grissom. Thank you.
All right. Thank you, everybody. I'll try to make mine brief. And for those of you who remember us from a year ago in the fall, we came in before, one of the things, early things we did was get approvals to expand the parking so that we could lease the balance of the property. I'm a local resident. I'm the Lincoln Property Company operating partner. I live in Western Springs. I used to work out at LA Fitness all the time. I need to get back there. My membership has lapsed. But I've come here all the time, and our partners on this transition, even though I work for a large national firm, are all local. So the owners of this are all local people: Oak Brook, Hinsdale, Western Springs, and then we have the national firm behind us. A brief history: as everyone knows, Buck bought the site in 1998, had a number of grand schemes came before Oak Brook for approvals, had a high dense site with the entire site covered with two levels of parking, below grade and surface parking, back in 2007. A year later, when the market crashed and kind of the market went away from them, they abandoned that plan. The condo market crashed, and they went to another plan, which actually had a pinstripe bowling alley, had a plan for a hotel, and a lot of retail at that time. And nothing happened. And Buck continued to own the property, and as we all know, between 2009 and 2013, they built the LA Fitness. They built these outbuildings, as you see it today, with the retail, with Real Urban Barbecue, Chipotle, Rody, and then the retail center, when we acquired the site, was half vacant. Since they built the retail, I'll call it the LA Fitness building, as everyone will recall, the backside of that building was vacant from the time they built it in 2009 until we bought it at the end of 2015. And when we bought the site, we came into the village and we said, okay, what would you like to see done? We heard a couple things. Number one, we'd like you to come up with a plan to finish it. It's been too long vacant. We would really appreciate you looking at alternative uses and come up with a great plan. Number two, they were not pleased with the landscaping. I think people in the village had felt, I don't know, Buck didn't do the plans. It didn't turn out the way they wanted. And they said, could you please improve that? We came back in the fall of 16. We had several of the trustees, John Barr came out. We had people from the zoning board who were landscape people. And we said, let's improve the landscaping. We did that. You can't tell it today, it's a little cold out and there's not a lot of leaves on the trees, but I think over the next few years, you're gonna see all the improvements we've done make a big difference. So this was like a case study to us. We had this north pad and west pad vacant. We had pad one up front off of 22nd Street, and it was a question of what are we gonna do to bring this property to fruition? And we looked at a lot of different things, and we did things. We got the additional parking improved so that we could pursue office tenants and we could realize what's happening, because Buck, when they abandoned their plans back in 2008 with the two levels of parking, kind of committed to a surface lot development with only so much development you can do. I mean, the reality is one of the great things that Bob brings to us is he's really the only use that can afford deck and below grade parking for this development. And the other thing he didn't mention, He's actually overparked it because all of the employees that work in the Senior Lifestyle Center will park underground under his center, so it won't impact our ability to lease the retail. So anyway, we after we got the property, we started looking for alternative uses. As I think everybody knows, on Pad 1 up on 22nd Street, we just recently started with a TD Ameritrade. I'm happy to say we just paid our permit fee of $48,000 to the village over the past few weeks, and we've started construction on that, and they'll move in this spring. Right now, they're down the street where the new Michael's Jordans is. They're in that complex, and they're going to move down the street and consolidate their Western operations. We looked out, and we said, okay, what are the different alternatives we could use for the site? Our partners in the transaction is Foxford. Foxford is a condominium developer. When we first looked at this, we thought this was a possibility for condominiums. In fact, Foxford is building 28 units in downtown Western Springs today, and it's under construction. And we looked out and we met with market experts. We reached out to capital markets groups, and we said, let's explore the condominium option. That was exciting to us. Buck had tried that back in 2007. And we basically went to the who's who of condo developers in the Chicago area. And here's the list of them. And for various reasons, they weren't interested. I don't know if anyone saw the article in the paper on Sunday. There was an article in the Tribune, and it was about all the apartments that are getting built in the suburbs. If you think about Chicago today, multifamily housing downtown the last several years has been about 6,000 to 8,000 units per year of apartments built in downtown Chicago. It's now moving to the suburbs. In the suburbs, as this report said in the paper, there has been between 3,000 and 4,000 units per year of apartments built in suburban Chicago. We've talked to all the experts. We've gone out of all of suburban Chicago today, the amount of condominiums being built in total is less than 200. They're all transit-oriented developments in downtowns. There's LaGrange. I think Downers Grove has one like 55 units. There's some in Oak Park. There are all these smaller, less than 30 unit developments. Up in Lake Forest, there's a couple. I think there's one planned for 40 units. And I know you've seen the one that's by the mall, which is very unusual because not many of them are not located train oriented. So we went to the who's who of list. And really, when we went through that, they directed us and they said, really, the people you should talk to is senior housing. And through that process, actually, we had three senior housing developers come to us looking at the site. We had no one. Not a single person interested in developing condos at the site. And of the three people that came, we thought Bob was the best. He had the best firm. Just like Trustee Barr, I went up and looked at what they did up north, and I thought it was a perfect solution for us. So we really explored the condominium option. I don't know if anyone has questions about that. We spent a ton of time, talked to everybody, but this was kind of the primary list we looked at and we marketed to, but we didn't have any action on that at all. The other thing we looked at was retail. When we bought the site, we interviewed every retail broker in town. We hired who we thought was the best. We switched to Buck had previously had. Brendan Reedy's here from Cushman & Wakefield. He's our guy. As I said, if you look at the site, the LA Fitness building, if the frontage facing York Road does fine. We brought in Steam Coffee, and they took the old ravioli space. On the backside, we really dropped our rents quite a bit, and as everyone knows, we brought in Egg Harbor. The other reason we brought in Egg Harbor is their hours of operation are 6:30 a.m. to 2:30 in the afternoon, then they close. We can't conflict with the LA Fitness, which everyone knows when you go to health club, it's 5 to 7 o'clock at night, and that's when the parking lot is full. So Egg Harbor worked beautifully. We still have the other side, the other vacancy. Again, it's been vacant since the building was built. The floors have rocks. It's been since 2008. It's very difficult. We have meetings every week with our leasing broker beating on his head to bring us tenants. There has been no action. I really think the most we could ever come up with is in the back of the site. We've done a plan here. We could maybe build another 8,500 square feet, have a couple of restaurants. We already have 7 restaurants. They would not have great visibility. I really think the retail, and if you have questions, we can have Brendan here. That's why he's here. The retail option is very, very difficult for the back of the site. And I really didn't know that coming into the buying the transaction. The other thing we looked at was office development. C.B. Richard Ellis was a tenant we pursued. C.B. Richard Ellis is on Commerce Drive. They've been a longstanding resident of Oak Brook. They were looking to do something special. We said, let's build them a new building. They needed 5 per 1,000 parking. I would have needed to build a deck. The economics to building a parking garage on this site are about $30,000 a space. $30,000 a space with 5 per 1,000 parking absolutely destroyed the economics. I then went after Hub Group before they bought the site to the north. And I tried to get them to come there. And really, if you look at their site and what they've done and expanded their site, everything they've done, they went and bought the site to the north because of the surface parking, and they can continue to expand. So we really couldn't, you know, it wasn't economically feasible on the office site as well, but I wanted to explore that. I'm an office guy. I'd like to build an office building, but there just wasn't the market, and the mathematics do not work. This was a big, beautiful rendering of the C.B. Richard Ellis building that they did not take, but that's the kind of thing. It's kind of a cool building. The other thing we looked at was hotel. Again, all the hotel use were the limited service hotels. They wanted, again, surface parking. We actually planned, and this was one of our schemes, and we could build about 128 units. I actually think the demand for this went down the street. If you look, right, they built a five-story building, 144 units. Hyatt House was one of the groups. We actually had talked to several operators who had different types of hotel uses, but they were all the limited service. And I think our shot at them went down the street. I don't know. We'll have to see how they do. I hope they do well. I've visited it. I think it's a great amenity. It's very similar to this, right? It's a five-story, 144 unit. That's kind of the guys that were looking at our site. So I guess, and here we are today, and this lays out the plan inclusive of the senior housing. So I guess my comment is we want to work with the village. We're trying to bring this property to its full potential. I've looked at all the food groups. I really have, and I would like, I really think this is the best use. I can't create demand. One thing I've learned in the business, I've been with Lincoln 31 years, we have to respond to the market, what the market will give you. And really what the market has given us is this senior housing, which I think would be wonderful for the community. We're fully supportive, our tenants are supportive, and I hope that you are as well. Thank you.
Are you guys done?
That's our official presentation, but we're available to answer any questions if anyone has anything.
We'll open up to a trustee discussion.
Great, thank you.
Anyone who wants to make a comment? Yeah. Trustee Manzo?
Well, I talked to a number of Oak Brook residents regarding this development, and they have some reservations, not about senior housing in Oak Brook. I think there is a need there. I think that this is a wonderful development. It would be a great development in Oak Brook. The concern obviously is placing it in the middle of a commercial retail district. Looking at what we're facing here in Oak Brook with the loss of revenues, continued loss of revenues. I think our sales tax are down about $500,000. They may continue to go down. McDonald's going to be vacating. We have some serious challenges. You know, there's a couple vacant pieces of property down York Road. I think that would be ideal for this location. There was a 300-unit apartment building going to go up on York Road next to Forest Glen. That never happened, but that would be ideal. It'd be even closer to the hospital, Elmhurst Hospital. I think the development is fantastic. I think that this is a quality development. The concern of the residents is losing prime commercial retail space. That's the major concern right now. In 2007, the market fell off. We had years of no development. The PUD that was passed, I don't know if you were on the board in 07 with the PUD, that was a wonderful development. It was uniformed, it was organized, and since then it's been kind of, you know, cut and paste and trying to put something together. A number of structures that go up, like Ameritrade, Charles Schwab, others, producing absolutely no retail. It's concerning. But as far as the development, it's a quality development. I think in other areas of Oak Brook, more residential areas of Oak Brook, it would be a wonderful fit in the opinion of many residents.
Any other trustee comments? Seeing none, can I have a roll call vote, please?
Trustee Youssef?
No.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
No.
Trustee Manzo?
No.
Trustee Tiesinger?
No.
Four no's and one yes.
Motion fails. Trustee Barr, you still have the next item. Variations to the Clearwater Drive 2055.
Isn't this predicated on...
No,
the previous motion?
Attorney tells us that we need to do that. Do you want to explain?
Sure. Trustee, we have two applications pending, one for the special use amendment and one for the variance, and both are phrased separately on the agenda, so both need a vote. So we will need to call a question on this, despite the fact that the last motion just failed.
Okay.
Are we allowed to ask a question?
No, we are moving on to the next subject already.
Can we ask a question before the next subject, or when you consider the next subject, will you give me the opportunity?
Yeah. Go ahead. I gave you ample opportunity, but go ahead. Yeah.
Well, I think what we're just trying to understand as you go into this next vote, if you have to do this, is there were four votes no, and I'm just kind of, we would like to better understand what the rationale is for the no votes. No one has explained why they voted no. I think it would be very helpful for us because we've invested an enormous amount of time and resources to make sure that we've tried very hard to address your concerns and to meet with people in advance. So I think we'd like to better understand what the concerns are.
I think you've met many of the individual elected officials already, and I think you know.
Well, they actually were three people.
All about. Yeah, right. Yeah, I
three
don't see
people
that.
We didn't meet with, two of whom voted no. Three of whom, I can't remember how.
There's no need for a debate here.
The question's fine. The board's not obligated to respond.
Thank you. Trustee Barber, would you move on to the B?
Okay. In spite of my thinking that this is just not needed because the previous motion failed,
We have to go by what the village attorney thinks. Yeah.
Well, we could table it too, couldn't we?
What's that?
We could table it too. Just leave it out there.
I think we need to act on it.
Procedurally, the proper move is to call the question and have the vote.
Okay. Kind of sticking a spike through it and making sure it's dead, right?
Our council.
I move that the village board approve the requested variations to sections 13.3.17b. 2, 13, 10E, 3C, 2, 13, 12, 7G, 2, 13, 12, 7A1, 13, 12, 4C of the village code for the senior lifestyle development to permit and allow the construction of a 200-unit senior housing development subject to the following conditions. One, obtain final approval of the proposed special use to amend ordinance S1183 to allow for the construction of the senior housing community, and two, authorize the village attorney to prepare the necessary ordinance for final consideration at the January 23rd, 2018 Board of Trustees meeting.
Second. Any discussion? Seeing none, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
No.
Trustee Manzo?
No.
Trustee Tiesinger?
No.
Trustee Youssef?
No.
Okay.
Motion fails. Next, Trustee Barr, would you present the Oakbrook Police Department Edition Special Use Amending Ordinance S972 and make the appropriate motion?
I'm disappointed.
Okay, I move to concur with the recommendations from the Plan Commission and Zoning Board of Appeals and to approve the request to amend Special Use Ordinance S972 to allow the construction of a 2,000 square addition on the Butler Government Center property located at 1200 Oak Brook Road, subject to the following conditions. One, construction shall be in substantial conformance to the plans as submitted. Two, all previously approved special uses and variations granted to this property not in conflict with this request will remain in full force and effect. Three, notwithstanding the attached exhibits, the applicant shall meet all village ordinance requirements at the time of building permit application, except as specifically varied or waived. And four, authorize the village attorney to prepare the necessary ordinance for final consideration at the January 23rd, 2018 Board of Trustees meeting.
Second.
Second?
Second.
Any discussion? Yeah, Mr. Manzo?
Have we determined, Jason, is the financing going to be the bond issue? So from Chapman to Cutler?
Well, they would be the bond counsel.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right.
Any further discussion?
This is
go ahead.
This is a zoning issue right now for allowing the use. Is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. It's an amendment to the existing special use. There are no variations being requested by the village.
At some point, I'd like to see us change things around so we have a little more latitude on our own village government campus in terms of doing stuff we need to do without having to go through this process. That we're going to decide to spend the money, and ultimately we're going to vote on the variation that we'll have to request, but we go through this cumbersome process if there's something down the road. So just a suggestion to streamline things in the future.
I tend to agree with you. Right now we're treating ourselves just like we're treating others, and I tend to think our process is not so cumbersome, because this is what we're having our developers and other business owners go through. But I agree there could be provision in the future maybe for more minor changes such as this. This is only a 2,000 square foot addition on a 10-acre campus. So there might be some latitude that we put in a future ordinance amendment that could accomplish your objective.
Yeah, we're not changing the underlying use or the mission, if you will, but just kind of fine-tuning the capabilities. Sure. I don't mean it should be wide open to do anything we want here, but it's cumbersome in the sense, in my opinion, that we're going to vote on a project. We're going to vote to spend the money. And ultimately, after it goes through this process, we're going to vote to approve the original design that we already voted to go ahead and spend the money to do. That's my point. Mm-hmm. You know, in other cases, we're reviewing what others want to do and whether it's a good decision or not. But that decision about whether it's a good decision or not is already made when we decide to go ahead with the project and make the expenditure. It's the same board.
Go, Paul.
Yeah. Any discussion? Yeah. Trustee Manzo? Yeah.
Are you finished?
Yes, sir.
Okay. The only thing I want to do is just remind the board that the village property, including the police department, is tied to our Amazon bid. So I don't know when we're going to hear a word, probably within the next 90 days, without discussing what's in the bid. There is a connection there, so it might make sense to hold off. But I just wanted to remind the board of that.
Any further comment? Seeing none, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
No.
Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Okay, motion carries. I can't believe it, Trustee Barr, you're still on. Resolution R1695, and make the appropriate motion regarding the Pine Oak Partners.
Okay. Motion to approve resolution R2018 Polo AG R1695, a resolution approving a license agreement between the Village of Oak Brook and Pine Oak Partners LLC for the 2018 polo season.
Second.
Any discussion? Yeah. Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes, I've reviewed this agreement, and I'd like to commend our village attorney for the careful attention paid to the intellectual property issues that I know came up in some discussion when we found our polo team wearing jerseys with the flag of the city of Chicago on them while playing in India. And I appreciate the language in here, which allows this board to control the use of the marks, and which also has a limited, non-exclusive, conditional license. So I that made a lot of sense to me. I do have a specific question, though, and perhaps it's to our village manager or maybe to Trustee Barr or someone else who's been more directly involved in this. At page 578 of the packet, which is, we'll start with page 579, which is section 12 of the agreement. It says that we will pay $65,000 in to the Pine Oak Partner Group. And then at the previous page, 578, says they will refund us these payments of $2,500 each, which gives us back $20,000.
Right.
And so it looks like we're net $45,000 exposed and the dollars in.
Correct.
But the memo said there was a $65,000 budget commitment. So is it $65,000 or $45,000? I just
it'll be 65 with a $20,000 reimbursement, so it's actually 45. So I just wanted to make sure that everybody knew that. It's been exactly the same since we've entered the agreements in with Pine Oak.
Okay,
$15,000 is going to come from the hotel committee sponsorship. That's where it usually comes from. The $20,000 is reimbursed for field maintenance. And then the $30,000, we actually moved that to the hotel, coming out of the hotel fund this year.
Okay, so the money that we get back on the rebate goes back into our general fund? Mm-hmm. Yeah. And the sources of the money were 45 from, 30 from the hotel, and 15 from
well,
the...
Well, that comes out of the hotel also.
Okay.
Yeah.
So it's actually no general fund exposure to us?
No. Correct.
Well, I thought that was an important point. That's kind of the way it looked to me, but I just wanted to make sure of that. So if somebody says, how much do we have into Polo, we can basically say, no, none of our general fund.
That was one of the things, I'm sorry, that we changed this year during the budget process. We talked about that.
That looks like an improvement.
Mr. Bonner?
Yes. And Sean might want to comment too, but part of the reason why we're paying them is that it's my understanding that field condition is extremely important to the Polo players. And this past season, we only got the level of play and the players that we did because Sean brought this field up to a championship level of play. And by fronting them the money and then paying back, it gives them a comfort level that if we don't do the field, they have to do it. And so they'll still have Polo there. I mean, Sean, is that kind of your understanding?
You're absolutely correct. They were very concerned in the past that the field wasn't good enough and they couldn't attract the good players. They wouldn't come if the field wasn't better. And the field is much better.
So this is kind of a guarantee.
Yeah, they were always scared about it. So this was why they paid it in payments and monthly or $2,500, whatever it was. But
right.
Yes, they were very concerned about fields.
So correct, none of the money's coming out of general fund. We're getting this 20 back and the rest of it, the 45 is coming out of the 25 we're getting back, 45 is coming out of hotel motel extensively because Polo is really pulling in international players and they are making a difference with, as they say, beds and heads, or heads and beds, one of those things.
That's correct.
Yeah.
Okay, and so any further discussion? All those in favor say yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Any objection? Motion carries. Next. Do we need a roll call vote for that? You okay with that, Rick?
You're spending 45.
Let's do a roll call vote.
Roll call vote? Okay. Yeah. One more time, sir. Even though we are budget neutral here. Yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Motion carries here. Yeah. Next, confirmation of appointments. I'd like the board to approve the reappointment of Mr. Jeff Bulin to the Oak Brook Zoning Board of Appeals to a term that expires in 2022. Just a small background on Oak Brook ZBA is comprised of 7 members. Each commissioner serves for a total of 5 years. Jeff Bulin has been on the ZBA since 2008 and has expressed interest in being reappointed. Mr. Bulin has proven to be an asset to the commission. He also comes in from a landscaping background, something that the ZBA finds very useful in their conduct of the commission. So I would like to seek a motion for this reappointment for Mr. Jeff Bulin for a term to expire in 2022.
So moved. Oh,
second. Any discussion?
Yeah, I would just like to add that Jeff is not only a landscape architect, but he's a architect also, a building architect, licensed in Michigan. So he's qualified.
Quite a qualified, yeah, right. Any further discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor say yes?
Yes.
Yes.
Any objections?
No.
Motion carries. Information and updates, village manager, Rick?
Just want to remind board members that we have another Sports Corps Advisory Committee meeting on Thursday evening at 7 o'clock if you want to attend. Thank you.
Charlotte?
I'm going to pass tonight.
Thank you. Asif?
Pass.
Pass. John?
Yes.
Mr. Manza?
Quick update. Since our last meeting, the Village of Westmont has approved the development on 35th and Midwest Road, which includes a seven-story apartment building. Actually, will be larger than the Oakbrook Hills Hotel. Also, a 1,200-seat natatorium. There were a number of residents. We had five subdivisions represented from Oakbrook, two from Westmont that went to the meeting to speak. But the plan was approved, so I believe they're starting construction as soon as the weather breaks. But I did want to thank all the residents from Oakbrook that went to the meeting, spoke. We have a former village president, Karen Bushy, was there. Association presidents were there involved in the process. But I did want to extend my thanks to them regarding this matter.
Thank you. Trustee Tasinga?
I'll pass.
All right. Village attorney?
Nothing tonight, Mayor. Thank you.
You don't want to tell us about your on-call schedule? You just had a little baby, 2 weeks old, I believe.
Yes.
Congratulations.
December 22nd. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you, Mayor.
Congratulations.
Not much sleep.
Couple of sleepless nights.
Yes, so. Just a couple.
All right. Moving on to our departmental directors. Jim?
Staff is finalizing plans on the new monopole tower. We received final plans from Verizon to build the new tower. It's being reviewed by Development Services and Public Works Departments. We expect construction to start sometime in early spring.
Thank you. Jim?
Thank you. Just a reminder to our residents, over the weekend we had three vehicles entered again, and all three were unlocked again. So please lock your cars. So,
are these again from the driveways or from the...
Pardon me? In the driveway,
in
yes.
In the driveway.
Yes.
Okay.
Thank you.
Sean?
Just an update on golf improvements. We had our second interview with a second interview with an interior design company for the improvements at the golf course. They showed a lot of promise, actually, because they've done a lot of golf course clubhouses and outdoor patios. So hopefully in the next week or so, we'll have a proposal from them. And we can start working on the golf clubhouse improvements. Thank you.
There you go. Thank you. Jake?
Nothing tonight. Thank you.
Jason? Barry? Tony, anything going on in the village?
My goodness.
No.
Oh, right.
All right. We then have a motion to, may I have a motion to adjourn to closed session for the purpose of discussing, number one, minutes of the meetings lawfully closed under this act. Number two, litigation pending against, affecting, or on behalf of the village, or probable or imminent litigation against or by the village. And number three, appointment, employment, compensation, discipline, performance, or dismissal of specific employees of the public body or legal counsel for the public body pursuant to 2C21, 2C11, and 2C1 of the Illinois Open Meetings Act, respectively.
So moved.
Second.
Any discussion? Being none, roll call vote, please.
Trustee Barr?
Yes.
Trustee Cuevas?
Yes.
Trustee Manzo?
Yes.
Trustee Tiesinger?
Yes.
Trustee Youssef?
Yes.
8:27 p.m.
Okay.